Good afternoon and welcome to the Preservation Association of Lincoln Brown Bag Lecture Series. My name is Eileen Burkton. I'm the coordinator of these brown bags. If you're interested in these programs, please join our membership. You can go to preservelincoln.org. Today is the 23rd of a series of lectures with Jim McKee. Support for this series is provided by Speedway Properties. And we'd like to thank Speedway Properties for their generous support of the videotaping associated with this series. Our speaker today is Jim McKee. Jim is a lifelong Lincolnite. His great-grandparents pioneered in Lancaster County in the 1870s. Jim has a bachelor's degree from UNL and operates J. and L. Lee Company. Jim has written over 1,000 articles and books on Lincoln and Nebraska history. Jim is on the Nebraska State Historical Society Board of Trustees and also serves on the City of Lincoln Historic Preservation Commission. He is also a founding member of the Preservation Association of Lincoln. This is a series of talks titled Jim McKee's Compleat History of Lincoln, and this is program number 23. And Jim invites you to ask questions during the program. Please join me in welcoming Jim McKee.
We will take up approximately where we left off last time, if everything figures out correctly, and talk about a couple of downtown businesses for sure. And the one we want to start with is Mayer Brothers. The building may look familiar to you, and we'll explain why. In the 1870s, three brothers, the Mayer brothers, Charles, Henry, and Simon, moved to Plattsmouth, Nebraska, and there they set up a clothing store. And it was successful and profitable, and in the period of about 1880-1881, they opened a branch store in Lincoln at 122 North 10th Street, which would put it approximately a quarter of a block north of the corner of 10th and O, along in there where we find one of the very earliest buildings of Lincoln having been built, the bank and so forth. In 1895, another gentleman came to Lincoln by the name of John Fitzgerald. We know him as Lincoln's first millionaire, and he built his home, we've talked about before, over in the Emerald Heights district, which is runs roughly from 17th Street to 20th Street, from A Street to D Street, Mount Emerald, we call it today. And his house was dead in the middle of that little tiny lawn, which he kept as his home. He also had a great interest in railroads. Primarily, he was a railroad builder, but he has a lot of real estate interests around the state, as well as banking and other things. He then bought properties along the south side of O Street between 10th and 11th, roughly from the old First National Bank building towards the east. In 1890, this building, which had, he called it a unified front, became Mayer Brothers. And as we see it here, it says Mayer Brothers New Store. The building that is behind that is literally a building of the 1880s, 1890s in Lincoln that he built originally, or maybe two different buildings cobbled together as one. The O Street front makes it look like a building that was probably built in the 1920s or even later than that, of terracotta primarily. We'll talk about that more in just a little bit in a few minutes. In 1911, Mayer Brothers was reorganized with Eli Shire becoming the president, and you'll notice on the front of the building here, if you can barely read it, just above the marquee, it says Eli Shire, president. 1928, Eli Shire retired, which was a really wise time to retire if you could, because we know what was coming around the corner. And with his retirement, the store stayed in business but started offering ever-deepening discounts from 1928, 1929. And finally, in 1931, Mayer Brothers' store did close. It became first W.T. Grant & Company and part of the building. Then another dime store, or a five and dime, or that was called then as a nickel to dollar store called Silvers. F&W Silvers, still in the same front that we see it here. Then the Three Sisters Clothing Company, which is really about the time I remember it coming along. Then Wells, W-E-L-L-E-S, Women's Clothing Mart. Then the Goal Post Restaurant. It starts changing hands kind of frequently at that point in time, becoming George and the Dragon, or St. George and the Dragon's Tavern. ate in there once. I think that's about how long it lasted, and became St. George's Antique Mall. When that antique mall went under, or closed or moved, whatever they did, I lost track of them. The store is literally empty and has been empty ever since. So it's been decades the building has sat empty. In 2014, it was announced that Mac Practice was going to tear down that building and in fact building a 9-story building in its place. Mac Practice, however, stayed down in the Haymarket District. I think they maybe in one of the Speedway properties, which is the old HP Law building, if I'm not incorrect. So they're still there. But the building did not get torn down, so we're waiting for someone to step up and build a 9-story building in its place. But who will it be? We have no idea. Now, let's see if I can change it without changing everything in the room, and I think I've got it figured out. They've also moved it further away so I can't bump it, which is wisdom. A man by the name of Artemus Roberts was born in 1841 in Missouri, and after university he studied architecture, becoming a full-time architect in 1867, which is an interesting time. That's the year Nebraska statehood. He came to Lincoln in 1871 when the city was certainly in its infancy. And he designed the first Lincoln High School building, which sat pretty much in the middle of the block where now we have Pershing Municipal Auditorium, so not the present Lincoln High School building. He also at that time designed the Charlton House, which is near Roca on the west side of the highway there, which is still there. And the last I knew, it was not a Montessori school, but a school similar to Montessori, something Hill School, and I can't remember what it was. It's still there as far as I know. Also in 1874, he purchased a quarter section of land that started roughly, you can think of it today as A Street and 56th, and ran towards the southeast. And he built a home for himself there, which would have been at about 58th, 59th, and Franklin, but it wasn't on a street because it was strictly just farmland at that point in time, faced towards the south, and we do have photographs of it. Then in 1874, his son, James Russell Roberts, was born. He attended first Lincoln Normal University, which was about 3-4 blocks directly south. Lincoln Normal University sat on the grounds that is currently Madonna's Rehabilitation Hospital. And the architect for that building was Artemus Roberts. Lincoln Normal University and then James Roberts went to the University of Nebraska and got a degree there as well. Then in 1903, he started a small dairy with a milk route in Lincoln. But primarily his deliveries were in the village of Normal, Nebraska. And Normal, Nebraska, sort of its epicenter was about 56th and South Street. There was a little business district in there with a bank, a church, a post office, and so forth. Primarily his milk delivery was in that general area. 1911, he incorporated Roberts Dairy, named, of course, for himself. And they were, at that time, the only pasteurized milk dairy in Lancaster County. The business itself was located at 1524 N Streets. They, of course, had dairy farms out near Normal, Nebraska, and east of Normal. Interestingly, too, about a block to the west of their dairy was another dairy, directly next to what we think of as the Hayloft Barn or Hayloft Theater, which still stands, which is owned by the Faulkners, and still Rich Faulkner lives there. But the dairy, the other dairy, the second dairy, was just to the west of that. So three businesses in a row right there, one of which still has its barn. And Rich Faulkner uses it for his car collection, which I think is only one car, so don't worry about it. I think it's a Corvette and his model railroads and so forth. The stables for this dairy were at 1948 N Street. So even at 1948 N Street, we're beginning to get into the country. That's mostly just houses at that point in time. In 1918, he began branching out and opening branches in other areas. The first one was in Sioux City, Nebraska, and Sioux City, Iowa. It's unclear exactly which one it was. He built a house then at that point in time at 220 South 20th Street, 1920. He opened branches in Grand Island and Omaha, and then his father, Artemus Roberts, will design a house for James on the south side of South Street at about 43rd Street. That house is still there, and if you drive by, you'll recognize that it sits on a rather large piece of property, and as near as I can tell, it has no front door. I don't know if you've ever looked at it, Matt, but it really is an unusual property, but it was designed by Artemus Roberts nonetheless. 1944, James Roberts Sr. passed away. The business passed to his son, J. Gordon Roberts. J. Gordon Roberts tells about standing in his father's house at 43rd and South, looking off to the east and watching his grandfather's house burn to the ground. That house would have stood probably east of what we think of today as of Roberts Park. The old dairy on South Street was turned into Roberts Cheese Factory. Roberts Cheese Factory at that time was the largest cheese factory in Nebraska, probably in any state even that touched Nebraska, and in the area was second only to Wisconsin in cheese production. Later, they turned that building into a fruit juice factory. We can watch that original barn building slowly get built around and changed. And finally, it becomes a hall for a Catholic organization. Still, they build a new building in there, but it's right there. I'm trying to think of the name of that organization. Somebody can help me out. Knights of Columbus, yes. And the Knights of Columbus building sits right on the site of the old cheese factory, fruit juice factory, and barn. And I always said if you went to a wedding reception in the original fraternal building and you thought you smelled cheddar, probably because it was the same building, but of course it's not gone. That building also was for a time a branch of the YMCA, so it had a lot of uses. That old barn got converted and used for a lot of different things. 1953, they interestingly opened a branch in Tampa, Florida, so they're going pretty well crazy. Everywhere, 1960s, they bought Skyline Dairy and merged it into their opposition. They also bought other dairies in Colorado, Florida, and Omaha, so it became larger and larger and larger. In 1970s, they bought something called the Fairacre Dairies, and the Platte Valley Foods Company was formed. 1972, Gordon sold all his stock to the American Beef Company, and the office was moved to Omaha, Roberts Dairy. 2005, the apparent heir of all that company was called Highland Roberts, H-I-L-A-N-D, Roberts. So the milk we still buy is Roberts milk, only it's Highland. Sometimes it says Highland, sometimes Highland Roberts. In 1930, and by the way, the sales of that firm, Highland Roberts, last year were a little over $300 million. So it has prospered and done well, but like a lot of things, it's changed its complexion completely. In 1930, they gave 16 acres of the original Artemus Roberts farmland of that 320 acres to the city of Lincoln to become a city park. And I lived, growing up 1940, on South Cotner Boulevard, and I can remember very clearly going out on an expedition all by myself and getting my canteen full of Kool-Aid and heading down 56th Street, which was a one-lane dirt road, and going over to Roberts Park. There wasn't anything there except a large circular driveway. And you can still see the path of those trees making that semicircle around at the bottoming out on 56th Street. And of course, over where the picnic shelter is, if you get over in that area, you can see a stack of stones about so far, which are the stones which stood on either side of the doors of Lincoln Normal University, which were designed by Artemus Roberts. And when it burned to the ground, the only thing that they saved were those stones, which ended up in a garden and later were given to the city to put right there by the picnic shelter in Roberts Park. So really nothing left in there, not much park, but you can see the curved area where the sort of driveway, if you will, it was And a driveway is the wrong way to put it because it was never paved, and it was a circular drive going nowhere. No picnic tables or anything at that point in time, but a city park nonetheless. Robert Furness, we think of as a territorial governor, living in Brownville. His house is still there and opened occasionally. In Brownville in 1859, he established the Nebraska Farmer newspaper or magazine. 1901, Samuel Roy McKelvey, not to be confused with the Sam McKelvey we think of as later being the governor, but Samuel Roy McKelvey graduated from the Lincoln Business School, which was located right over here a block away on the northwest corner of 14th and P Streets, and other businesses in there now, of course. And he began selling advertising for what was called the 20th Century Farmer, which was owned by the B newspaper in Omaha, but as a separate business. 1904, senior McKelvey purchased a house on the northeast corner of 26th and N Streets. It was a large house and had barns behind it and so forth. You can see it in there now just as a level place where they've torn it down below grade directly to the south of what used to be Jacob North Printing Company. He bought that house for $4,000. In 05, a man by the name of Edgecombe, who later became the president of the Nebraska Press Association, and still his daughter operates Service Press in Henderson, Nebraska, and several small newspapers around Nebraska. At any rate, F.O. Edgecombe purchased the Nebraska Farmer for $10,000, and he moved it to the city of Lincoln. 1906, Sam McKelvey, the son of Samuel Roy McKelvey, became the editor, well, the two of them, the father-son duo, became the editors of the Nebraska Farmer. Then in 1907, the son, Sam, took over completely. He also ran for the city council. He wasn't too successful. He came in number three in a three-man race, so he was not elected. Then in 1911, he was elected to the House of Representatives and later became the Lieutenant Governor of Nebraska. And while he was Lieutenant Governor of Nebraska, he had made a decision to run for governor, but he applied to run for governor, but found out it was illegal at that time for the Lieutenant Governor to run for governor when he was in office. That question went to the Supreme Court of Nebraska, and it was determined that he could not, in fact, run for governor at that point in time. So he set out until his term as lieutenant governor ran out, and he then ultimately became the governor of the state of Nebraska. And at that time, when he was elected governor, he was the youngest governor in the United States of any state. 1918, he will purchase the 20th Century Farmer, another magazine, and meld it into the Nebraska Farmer. 1918 is when he ran for governor of Nebraska. 1924, he will purchase Capers Nebraska Farm Journal. Capers Farm Journal is still operating, which my grandparents subscribed to, and it may still be business, I'm not sure. Capers was a large farm newspaper. That time he paid for $100,000, so the price of all these magazines is going up. 1935, Sam retired from active management, but in 1947 he came back and established the Colorado Rancher and Farmer, another magazine. The Nebraska Farmer continued to be published, and they were published in a building, a two-story long sort of a commercial building at 56th and O Street. They had pretty much all the second floor of it, and just a few years ago the sign came down, and I tried to figure out what happened to the Nebraska Farmer, and I determined by looking on Google, I found out it's still in existence, but apparently they don't print anything on paper anymore. It's strictly a web-based magazine, if you will, so it still exists. They have on their masthead three Lincoln telephone numbers, but no physical address. I haven't figured out where they are. So the Nebraska Farmer does still exist. Shogo Lithia started around a legend. And the legend was that there was an Oto Pawnee chief whose name was Chief Quench Hakaha or something like, I can't pronounce it. It was just a made up name. quench hada, quench has, you know, quenches your thirst, basically, but strictly made up. And they were using the lithium waters, which came from a spring near Milford, Nebraska. Lithium, of course, we think of as a great sort of calming influence, and so it probably was a pretty good drink. How much lithium was in the water is questionable, but they did advertise it, so there was some there. It was a very successful operation. They bottled this water and sold it all over the world. In fact, they were the water suppliers to the canal zone when they were building the canal, the Panama Canal. In the early part of the years, a poor farm was built literally on top of the springs, but it still continued to produce water, and it was trucked into Lincoln at that time. A man who was associated with was a Colonel Culver, C-U-L-V-E-R. In the 1890s, he had established there a soldiers and sailors home, which he ultimately sold to the state of Nebraska as a soldiers and sailors home, which morphed, the buildings morphed into the beginnings of the Southeast Community College at Milford in the 1940s. And the original buildings, a couple of them were still there at that point in time. Mr. Culver did okay by himself, however, by leaving the state of Nebraska and going to California, where he started a city, Culver City. So he did very well. And as we look back, another man in Omaha, at a similar time frame, his name was Gurdon, G-U-R-D-O-N, the only Gurdon I've ever run across, Gurdon Wattles, W-A-T-T-L-E-S. Think of having to live that down in junior high school, Gurdon Wattles. Gurdon Wattles in the 1890s, 1898 specifically, was the head of the Trans-Mississippi Exposition, which is a world fair held in Omaha. So he did very well, and he moved to California and bought a house and built perhaps the first, maybe the second house in a real estate development, which they now refer to as Hollywood. His house is still there, Gurdon Wattles is still there, and it is not only on the National Register, but is a museum. So a couple of Nebraskans did okay by moving to California for sure. Well, the bottling company survived, and here we see it in Lincoln, down around where Laszlo's has bought a square block of land from the old dairy that sat there, and they're going to turn it into housing, and I don't know what all. They're talking about buildings or moving some of their brewery over there, Laszlo's, maybe moving. They have a company out in Greenwood or Waverly that they're thinking about building in there. But at any rate, this building was recently torn down, but it sat right in that same square block on the eastern edge of the block. By 1910, this part of the business in Lincoln was owned by a man by the name of Morris Friend. Morris Friend we know of as being a large major stockholder in a little old company called Beatrice Foods. So Morris did okay too. In 1918, the Roerig family purchased the business, and some of us have been around long enough to remember the Roerigs, who had probably most famously were known for having a liquor store in Lincoln. But they bought the business and continued to operate it at 335 South 8th Street. Then in 1955, the business still in the city directories is known as the Shogo Dr. Pepper Company. So they were selling Dr. Pepper and probably bottling it, but also at the same time still distributing the old Shogo Lithia Springs Quenchada, or whatever they called it. Briscoe's, Laszlo's, and Empyrean Ale now on that block. This is looking down 27th Street towards the north and looking towards the corner of 27th and Randolph. The business we're talking about on the left here, their delivery truck has just met up with another car on 27th Street. This is a picture from the newspaper files. Gardner Moore is who we're going to talk about here. He came to Lincoln and started clerking in several grocery stores. Then in 1920, got a job with H.P. Law. He was offered then a partnership with a man by the name of Mr. Vidlock, V-I-D-L-O-C-K. They then set up business, or Vidlock already had the business set up, in what was called the Antelope Pharmacy Building on the southwest corner, roughly, of 27th and Randolph. And this building, I remember, it was later turned into a city parking lot, right on the corner right there. And they operated in the back part of the Antelope Pharmacy Building. The address was 811 South 27th Street. He then partnered with a man by the name of Arthur Myers, and together they bought the store out for $2,500 and was called Moore and Myers Ideal Grocery. They were paying $50 a month rent, so tough nut to cover, but they did. Mr. Vidlock stuck around and he operated a meat department for them, and pretty soon they realized they had hit $300 a week in sales, so they thought they were doing just okay. So in 1921, they built a new building directly south of the little east-west alley that runs still there next door to what's now Paramount Laundry on the north edge of Paramount Laundry. The address is now 821 South 27th Street. They had formed an agreement with the man who owned the old Antelope Pharmacy Building that he would not put another grocery store in. So within weeks, what he did was he rented their old spot to Piggly Wiggly, directly opposed to what he said he would do, but nonetheless. And about that, Piggly Wiggly did not last very long in that location, interestingly enough. But it is at about that time that Gardner Moore hired a man who had just graduated from Fairbury High School, whose name was Lyle Hans. And Lyle went to work for Gardner Moore. The first thing they did was they opened a second store at 27th and R on the southwest corner of that intersection. So they have a satellite store for the first time. But their second satellite store, which Gardner Moore will also turn over to Lyle Hans, is in the old Governor's Mansion on off 7th and Washington, which was, in a few years will become the original home of the Lincoln Country Club. But he will go down there, and Lyle told me some very interesting stories about that operation. Of course, the old country club building, which was the governor's mansion built around the old house, they had the grocery store on an enclosed porch around the old governor's mansion. And Hans Lyle was the sole employee. But in the meantime, the radio station KMA from Shenandoah, Iowa, had come to Lincoln, approached the city council to get a license to operate a satellite of KMA radio station in Lincoln in the old governor's mansion. And the city council, what they had to do with it, I don't know, but they authorized them opening a branch of KMA in there, and they would have broadcasts from Lincoln, but broadcasts through KMA in Shenandoah, Iowa. And Lyle tells a story about how they had one employee in the radio station, KMA, and he was the sole employee in the grocery store. The grocery store turned into kind of a outlet store where they would take produce, which was maybe just right at the edge of its sell-by date, move it down there and sell it. But when the man who was the station engineer for KMA needed to once in a while go on a little a trip to the little groceryman's room, if you will, then Lyle would operate the radio station. And in repayment to Gardner Moore for Lyle's operating the radio station for these brief periods of time, they got free advertising on KMA. That worked pretty well. They also, at that time, opened a new store down on the southeast corner of 9th and O Streets. And I'm looking at a building you're about to convert again. This is the building that most of us think of as Knickerbocker's. And that became a ideal grocery store location too. And they operated down there. Lyle said he wanted to try and break into the farm trade. By that meaning, I guess he thought farmers were more apt to come into a downtown store than they were to get over into a little residential area like 27th Street. And Lyle said that at that time he nearly broke his back carrying 50-pound bags of sugar and flour. And they would buy eggs and stuff from the farmers. That store didn't last there too long either. They then opened a small store at 11th and B Street. So Gardner's trying a lot of different things. Unfortunately, the time at that point in time is 1929. And it's going to close all of the stores with the exception of the 27th Street store. Now, in the meantime, HP Law, who is the wholesale grocer in Lincoln, one of many wholesale grocers in the city at about that same time, HP Law will build a new building further south from their store. So this will be their third location on South 27th. That's the building on the left. There's the front of the building. And the guy on the left is Lyle Hans. Can't tell you. I think the other guy...
Is that Thompson?
It's Tommy.
Yeah.
Yeah, Tommy. Can't see the rest of it. But that's the building as we remember it pretty much. HP Law built the building. He then leased it back to Gardner Moore for 1% of sales. Are you writing this down? 1% of sales. Pretty good deal. But of course, the other thing he got out of it is HP Law got out of it is they had an agreement where he had to buy all his wholesale groceries from HP Law. So it was a wash my back, I'll wash yours. At that point in time, this building, which is not as big as the building you remember, was the largest grocery store in the state of Nebraska. Almost seems incredible. Then HP Law started buying houses on both sides of it. He bought houses to the north, which would now be a north parking lot, and also for a while Gilmore's drugstore, and now part of Paramount Laundry, and also houses to the south. He tore them down and made parking lots and other buildings, the other buildings being the drugstore primarily, and what morphed into the buildings that Paramount Laundry uses. But he built parking lots on both sides of the building. This was unheard of for a grocery store to have parking lot. And they advertised, at that time, their advertisement said, oceans of parking. And not only that, but they had the largest grocery store and the largest parking lot in a grocery store in the state of Nebraska, again, very briefly. So, crazy how things work. Then, late in the 1930s, Gardner got the idea of what we would probably almost call an ASOP today, corporation. He sold 49% of his business to his employees, his key employees. And that will break down even further a little bit later on, where there will be sub-partners and so forth. It gets a little bit complicated. By 1990, he was the oldest grocery store still standing in the city of Lincoln. Then in 2012, Gardner has meanwhile passed away. It's gone to his son, who's passed it to his son, Jack, to Jim, and Jim and brothers will sell the store to Leon's. Leon's was established by Leon Adelson and Sam Davidson in 1954, still called Leon's, still in business today, but they will buy the business and apparently also, after some negotiation, will also buy the real estate. May 19th of 2016, 2 a.m. in the morning, the building will burn down, as I think virtually everybody in the city realizes. This is an interior of Ideal, which was added on to in the 1980s, and probably added on to about 25% of the building added to the north. This is the interior. This is Leon's, which still stands, and it's been added on to as well. Leon Adelson and Sam Davidson are both gone and now owned by another group. The question becomes, of course, what will happen at the old Ideal site? And no complete determination has been made at this point in time. However, the best information I have seems to indicate that they will not build there because, and this is kind of interesting, the city will not grant them the right to build a store as big as it was because there's not enough parking. who knows? That's just what I have been led to understand. Of course, the city has built across the street to the east from Ideal. They've torn down a couple of houses and a little apartment house, and they built a city parking lot over there. So there, to me, there's probably plenty of parking. I never had any trouble finding any parking, but nonetheless, Leon's is certainly busier in this picture than they are today. Okay, we're back downtown again. This is the southeast corner of 13th and O Streets. And 13th and O. In 1892, a young attorney had moved to the city of Lincoln by the name of Charles Dawes. Charles Dawes will ultimately become the Vice President of the United States, but at this point in time, he is an attorney with an office in the Burr Block, which is the 12th and O, the northeast corner of the block. I think we talked about that building last time. He bought this corner, however, the southeast corner of 13th and O, in 1892 for $32,000, which was a princely sum of money, and his friends all warned him, don't buy it. That's too far east of the downtown part of the city of Lincoln. It will never develop. But he did. He flew in the face of their suggestions and bought it anyway. The original tenant of the building was called the Nebraska Savings Bank. They had a rather spectacular demise during the Great Depression and received a lot of national publicity when they wiped out what they called their dime savings accounts, and little kids were losing all their paper delivery money and so forth, and they got bad national publicity out of it. Another man by the name of Morris Weil, W-E-I-L, had in 1902 opened a bank called the Bank of Commerce. His cashier, or the treasurer, was a man who had been the county treasurer and tax commissioner by the name of Martin Aitken. 1904, that bank received a national charter and became the National Bank of Commerce, and capital stock in their firm was at that point in time increased to $100,000. Then in 1924, the National Bank of Commerce, which has moved into the Nebraska Savings Bank building, which is technically called the Potvin Bank Building, P-O-T-V-I-N, the man who built the building, Mr. Potvin, they will then move Caddy Corner to the northwest corner of 13th and O, and they will buy that property from a man by the name of Charles Dawes. And Charles Dawes had purchased that piece of property in 1893 for $18,500. So they'll move Caddy Corner and build a building that we see here. After 43 years, Mr. Weil turned the bank over to Byron Dunn, the first guy who I knew, and I think, Matt, you even wrote an article on Byron Dunn, didn't you, some little time ago. Byron Dunn had started working at the Bank of Commerce, or National Bank of Commerce, in 1905 at the salary of $25 a month. So he did move up a little bit from there. Then in 1955, this is the bank under construction, and here we see the same bank completed. It was one of those buildings that was skinny and tall and looked like if the good wind came out of the south, it might blow it into 13th Street, but it was a pretty solid building. This is the banking lobby inside, looking towards the north. 1955, they purchased Mayor Zerung's townhouse, which was located directly to the west of the Varsity Theater building on P Streets. They then tore down the old Varsity Theater building and the townhouse belonging to Mayor Zerung, which we had pictures of, and maybe we've covered that sometime in the past with 23 episodes. I don't remember. Do you remember, Matt? Lowell, you've been to most of them. I think we must have covered that before. Anyway, they both came down, and the townhouse became the first drive-in banking facility in the city of Lincoln, an adjunct of the National Bank of Commerce. Here we see them tearing down the building on the corner, the Varsity Theater building, which by that time is already, we covered that a long time ago, has had its name changed from the original Lansing Theater building. And they will then ultimately begin building a new building occupying the site of the National Bank, or the Bank of Commerce, National Bank of Commerce, and the Varsity Theater building. We're standing here on top of Duane Ackley's building, which is the old Woods building, directly to the south of Walgreens on 13th Street. And my office at that time was on Q Street, and I walked every day to lunch, basically at Miller and Payne's Tea Room. And I would walk then over to Duane Ackley's building, and at that time I could get access to the roof. I'm sure that Duane didn't know it. But I got on the bank, on the roof, and I took pictures, not every day, but quite frequently, of the new building going up. And I will not belabor you with all the building pictures, but you can see it going up here. They also, in the meantime, have bought Hovland Swanson's on O Street, so they'll have a little bit larger presence on O Street until we see it virtually in completion here. I am Pay the architect. Interestingly enough, the cost of the building in completion was $10 million in round numbers, which is the cost of the present Capitol building in construction, $10 million in round numbers. People have said, and I don't know whether I Am Pay ever intended it or not, but if you looked at the east elevation of the building, it was the state of Nebraska. And it is, kind of, but I don't know whether it was ever intended as such or not. No one has ever told me one way or the other. And this is one of those buildings that they had to go back to the city and get permission, because I Am Pay, in all his ingenuity, has managed to design a building which goes, I think it's 12 or 18 inches into the city property on P Street. So they had to get permission to acquire that property from the city of Lincoln. Hard to believe that an architect could make that kind of an error. Could they, Gordon? Is that possible? But at any rate, they did, and ultimately the building is built. This is the Richards Building, which, in a manner of speaking, and I think we've covered this building before too, still stands, and we have on the ground floor the Dish Restaurant. That's the building you're looking at on the northeast corner of 11th and O Streets. It doesn't quite look like this anymore. It's had a tragic fire in it, and the building was recurtained with stone, but basically the interior of the building is still around the wood frame construction, not steel beam, but wood frame construction. The only steel, as far as I know, in the actual structure of the building is in the northwest corner of the building, which went around the elevator tower. Now it is condominiums and apartments above, and retail still on the ground floor. How are we doing on time, Eileen?
47.
Say it again?
It's 12:47.
Okay, fine. Yeah, but does that leave us how long? Okay, good. In this building, we'll start what's called originally the Old Line Bankers Life Insurance Company. Started by a man by the name of Mr. Lindley, who was the president, and the secretary was Mr. J.R. Richards. And of course, Mr. Richards owned the building, so it made only sense that they would be there. The first year, Old Line Bankers Life sold 281 policies. They rejected one policy. Total amount of insurance in force the first year, $344,000. They were capitalized at $100,000. Then in 1890, the business was taken over by John Ames, Albert Watkins, and Daniel Cook of Beatrice. And this is kind of the firm that some of us remember as just now Bankers Life. Mr. Cook hired the first full-time employee, a man by the name of William Wilson. He became the manager of Bankers Life, and they paid him $100 a month. So if you look closely, all these salaries and numbers are beginning to creep up on us a little bit. By 1892, they had $2 million worth of insurance in force, but they had one $5,000 death policy they had to pay out, and it was a close call. If they'd have had two of those, they probably could have even been in trouble. But they were not. They suggested, but it was what they considered their most major payoff, a $5,000 death benefit. And then in 1900, this building had the fire, and at that time, they moved temporarily to 11th and N Streets. 1910, they built a building on the southwest corner of 14th and N. By that point in time, they had $38 million worth of insurance in force. 1938, one of the primary owners of the business wanted out. And in order to do that, what they did was they mutualized the corporation, enabling them to buy him out. Then in the 1950s, this would probably be about 1956, 1957, Bankers Life purchased 17 acres of land on the northeast corner of Cotner Boulevard and O. They paid $4,600 an acre for the land at that point in time. George Cook received a more or less threatening letter from a major downtown investor and businessman who threatened him. He said, if you move Banker's Life out of downtown Lincoln, I will see to it that you never work in the insurance business again. George Cook didn't pay too much attention. and of course, they're going to move Banker's Life from the downtown building. And when they do that, when they vacate this building, one of the things they did that I recall is they parked a bunch of old clunkers, cars that were ruined around the building on the N Street side and the 14th Street side. Then they sold you the right for $5 to take a sledgehammer to any one of the cars, or for $5 you could throw a brick through the window of the Banker's Life building, with the funds being used to initially finance Lincoln Children's Zoo. And I don't know how it worked out, but the Children's Zoo, of course, came about. Then the Woods brothers, who own the property underneath this, will tear this building down. And it turns out to be one of those buildings that is very difficult to tear down. It was literally built as a huge vault. It had all sorts of vaults in the middle of the building, and it was very difficult to tear down. But the Woods brothers, for interesting reasons, left it as a ground floor parking lot. It's owned, that property, I think it's still owned by the Sahara Coal Company, which is the Woods brothers. And they also own the ground floor parking lot directly to the south, where they tore down their 3- and 4-story, almost quarter of a square block of building, which if they had left it, I think the state of Nebraska might possibly be one of those buildings that they would be interested in leasing back at this point in time, but it's gone. So they then move out to this corner of Cotner Boulevard and O, where the ranch market's at. Part of this property was owned by Tony Domino, who had the Italian Village restaurant. Part of it was owned by the Taylor family, who owned the section of land across the street to the south. And the Taylor section, that particular Taylor section, ran from A to O, 56th to 70th. It's all farmland when I was a kid, absolutely all of it. And in behind this building, after the war, probably about 1950, a group in Kansas, I believe the company name was Starsmore, started to build an outdoor theater. They built the basement of three different buildings, which would be the projector building and storage buildings and so forth. They then put the steel structure up for the screen of the theater, and at that point in time, it was determined by somebody that they were using steel, which had been condemned during World War II for the federal government's purpose. Never went any further, and so when Banker's Life purchased the property, they also bought the uncompleted outdoor theater building, as well as these poured concrete basements. Tore them out and tore this building down. And this is a picture where Banker's Life brought their employees out to look at the new site, Banker's Life. They brought them out in city buses. The building on the corner over there is the second building of my father's Fleet Wing Conoco station. Now, that building, this is the second building. The first building that was on the site is inside this building. It is very highly pitched, steeped, Beth Ann.
Five minutes.
Okay, great. And the building is built around here, and then this building is torn down, and a new building is built on the site, which until about a month ago had the Goodwill computer store in it. Now that building, the second or the third building that was on the site, was built of white cut Silverdale stone, which everybody assumed was made out of concrete block. But no building that sat on that corner was just a concrete block building. And in fact, one of the things that was done was they purchased from the old Banker's Life building downtown slabs of black, what would it be, marble or granite? Marble, I suppose, about like this, so thick. And they went around all of the doors with that black marble, which the telephone company was in there covered over. So underneath there, when ultimately that building is undoubtedly going to come down now, And the land underneath it is still owned by the Taylor Oil Company, Taylor Investment Company. And they're talking about a high-rise building up. That property is much, much too valuable for nothing or goodwill to sit on it. So that will come down as well. This is Earl Coryell's. We talked about the Coryell family last time. This is Earl Coryell, not L.L. Coryell. This is a relative of L.L. Coryell's. This is his filling station, which sat directly across the street from Bennett Martin Public Library to the west on the northwest corner of that intersection. And Earl had gas stations around the state of Nebraska. This one was advertised as being the largest gas station or filling station in the state of Nebraska. Another picture, which is very often publicized, is this one, which is the sheriff filling up his car at Earl Coryell's filling station. And the reason it gets a lot of attention is because it is, in fact, gasohol. It is 10% corn added to gasoline. But the reason they did this was not because gasoline was in short supply, or anything else that we can directly attribute that to economics. In fact, they thought, and they were going to try this at the Supreme Court if necessary, it was their contention that if 10% of the fuel was corn alcohol, you didn't have to pay tax on the gasoline. How did that work out? Not very well, but nonetheless, it was an interesting theory, and I thought it was interesting, too, that the picture shows the sheriff actually buying gas at the station. So we now have about 3 or 4 minutes left, so I'll ask if there are any questions on anything we covered today or any questions covering anything. Yes?
The landfill out by Cornhusker and I-180, was that a fill-in for the rerouting of Oak Creek or Oak Lake?
Okay, now just a minute. Your Cornhusker, the question was the land on Cornhusker Highway at Highway 2. Cornhusker Highway on what street?
At
I-180. At 180. And your question is that a fill? Well, let's look at, you're quite a ways out to the north. The major fill will come to the south of that. And you know where the interstate leaves downtown and you have the two lakes on either side? That was one lake originally. And there became a fill. Now that lake is one of the remnants of the salt flat. I'm not maybe answering your question, but I'm answering a question which enables me to run for almost any office, you know. You ask a question, I answer a question, but not that one. Now if you want to go further than that, I'm not sure of fill much further on, but where I-80 then crosses Cornhusker Highway on the southwest corner of that intersection is the old Lincoln City dump, which is landfill, okay, but not the other corners, not the other three corners. And then the further you get, there is no fill of any great amount as far as I know. Now, have I covered it a little bit?
Yeah, you got it.
Okay, great.
Jim, you showed a picture at 11th and O for Banker's Life. The buildings that were adjacent where Lawler's was, are those buildings, did they survive the fire?
They did. The question was, did the buildings which are directly east of the Richards block survive the fire? They survived that fire. The original fire that occurred on that corner was a two-story or one-and-a-half-story frame drugstore. And when it went down, it took not just the frame drugstore, but the two brick buildings to the east. And that's when these new buildings were built at the same time, roughly. The Richards building was being rebuilt. So they're old, but they survived this fire. They did not survive the previous fire. And of course, when the drug company moved out of there, they moved first to the Lincoln Journal building, then they moved to the northwest corner of 8th and P Streets, and ultimately became Lincoln Drug Company. More than you wanted to know. Okay. Another question? If not, I thank you. I'm not sure, do you know what the next program here is, Eileen?
Yeah, Ed Zimmer.
Ed Zimmer, next month, talking about who knows what.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.